For the closing session, we are first addressing a topic that we think it's very interesting also because the great role that the young researchers should play in this change of paradigm of how science is done. And for that, we have invited Julia Malaguarnera.
Perfect pronunciation.
Okay, she's Dr. Julia. She's now the University of Catania in Italy and researcher at the NEST Spin Lab in Catania. Her area of expertise deals with disorders related to aging, with more than 75 articles and more than 1,340 citations. But she's mainly now here as president of the European Council of Doctoral Candidates and Junior Researchers. And well, we'll be happy to hear her thoughts. So, Julia.
Okay. Thanks a lot for the inviting me. I will briefly introduce what is EuroDoc. EuroDoc is the European Council of Doctoral Candidates and Junior Researchers. We are an umbrella association which includes 28 national associations in Europe and in the European area. We are a non-profit organization established in 2002 and based in Brussels. We are independent, self-financed, and we are basically all volunteering for advocating for early career researchers. As early career researchers, so we mean PhD candidates. We call candidates and not students because we are advocating for employment condition. And we are also representing the postdoctoral researchers. Our objectives are, as I said before, to advocating on education, research and career development in Europe, to improve the working condition of early career researchers, to share information, raise awareness, organizing events, join debate and shape policy for early career researchers in Europe. And we work in collaboration with the research organization and policymakers in Europe. EuroDoc has done a very high job in open science. We really embrace the European Commission vision on open innovation, open science, and open to the world. In particular, in 2017, one of our former president, Gareth O'Neill, ran and participated to a European Commission survey in which we could see that the awareness of open science, in particular on guidelines, metadata, data management plans, were very poor among the young generation. So we worked hard during the last 4 years to increase the awareness among junior researchers. We also started a training program, which is called Open Science Ambassadors. And we also run some webinars, like the one on the right retention strategy, which is a new strategy to gain the copyright for the publishing and the figures that are published. And we are also working in collaboration with Open Research Europe, which is the new platform launched by the European Commission for publishing the manuscript and the open data from the Horizon beneficiaries. In particular, what we see that with open science is that all the skills that the junior researchers, the early career researchers are building are inside the skill set of the transferable skills that any researchers can use to move between the sectors. So not only in the research field, which is very important, but also moving into industry or in the third sector or in the public administration is really important that the early career researchers know what is open science. Our initiative, as I said before, are included the working group and the inside debating. We offer training and we work in collaboration of open science project, in particular with EOSC and the Open Research Europe. We also work in the policy statement. In particular, the most recent one was the UNESCO Open Science recommendation that was just approved a few weeks ago by the member states, in which open science is very well defined. During also the COVID pandemic, we worked on the raising awareness to support the open science measure. In particular, we endorsed the European Commission manifesto on European COVID-19 research. We really advocate for the usage, for the practice of open science, how to practice open science. The European Commission gave us the instruments to practice openly and in fair way open science. In particular, with the European Open Science Cloud, we can find a marketplace in which you can find many software to manage the data management, to publish with Zenodo, to even close some information that shouldn't be open with some software as Amnesia. But you can also find many other projects for a cloud system, for having an embargo period with some data. So it's very useful, not only for researchers, but also for industry and any kind of actors that is present in the research field. The Open Research Europe is a new platform that was launched on March 2021. And this is very useful because all the practice in open science are used in this platform. So you have the preprint, you can deposit not only manuscript, but also data. You can publish any kind of research output, either positive or negative. Then there will be an open peer review, and the article revision is still open. So it's like having a living document in the research field. We also ran recently a survey on open science that was more related on open science publishing. I will here report very few data that are just part of it, but I will focus more on the challenges in open science that we've seen among early career researchers. So what is the main concern in publishing in open science is mostly related to the journal impact factor. And this is the biggest problem because the open access venues are still low, are very, let's say, young. So the impact factor sometimes is not that high as a closed journal. However, the tendency is that, in particular in the Western country, there are other factors that matters in the research output. That are, for instance, high quality of peer review process, the open access to published work, and also the rapidness of publishing. When we go to the rewarding of open science that will be mostly discussed later, we see that people are not very happy to writing peer reviews, which is quite worrying. You can see that most of the responses say that they felt that it was not rewarding at all writing peer review. But we believe that with open peer review, we can have a change in the mindset. What are the opportunities in open science and the features in open science that are considered most important among our respondents were mostly open access, the reproducibility of the research as was discussed before, open and fair data. These are the top three. But the fact that we have low responses in other future of open science, it also means sometimes that this kind of field are not very known by the early career researchers. In any case, Eurodoc is contributing raising awareness among our members, so all the early career researchers from the start of the PhD till when we can, even the researchers, the senior researchers, to perform open science and raise awareness in the institution and perform in a fair way open science. We also provide feedback and user experience to the platform, as I said before, like EOSC and Open Research Europe. We also shape the policy with the policymakers at the European level. And this was my presentation, so thank you very much. I was brief because I know that the time is running. Feel free to contact me at any stage and ask me some questions. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Julia, and also for getting so tightly to the schedule. And so that we can move on time on to the last speaker, last but not least. And we have, I think, in many of the presentations and the debates talk also about how also the incentives and the metrics should change if we want to change to open science, the paradigm of how open science is made. And we asked Eva Mendez to close the webinar today addressing this topic. She is a tenured professor at Universidad Carlos III de Madrid. She's currently Deputy Vice President for Research Policy in Open Science in this university. And she has been involved in many international research teams dealing with the topic in OpenAIRE, Metadata 2020, etc. She's now the chair of the European Open Science Policy Platform. And Eva, we are waiting for your speech. So the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Carlos. Thank you very much, Ana Belén, for inviting me. Thank you very much, Greco, for having been such a successful project and make me part of this. I think it's an amazing opportunity to close up this journey, the journey of the Greco project that has been long but very powerful, and also the event today, which is the Inspiring Researchers for the Use of Open Science in their projects, which is something that we always really want to do, which is inspiring people to do things better. But the The point of talking about the future has always a very challenging proposal, because it's, you have to invent it, because the future, you don't know what is going to be the future. But we are very keen on constructing the future from the perspective of the present, which is the COVID-19 situation that we have all suffered a lot, and we have all learned about that science should be opened. But the other thing about talking in the last position of the day is that, what can I say that it has not been said yet? Or in my case, what can I say that it haven't said yet before in this project in another talks? So probably I will repeat myself, but I will try to do something like wrapping up, thinking about where we are now in open science and citizen science, in the new science that we really need. And the other thing is that where would we want to be? Where are we going to go? The next step is going to be Horizon Europe. And my question here is, are we just changing the date, or we are really changing the horizon? Because it's something like have this perception that we are moving the date of the target of open science happen. It was 2020, then it was 2021, and now it's 2030. Oof, we have 10 more years. Okay, take it easy. No way, we cannot take it easy. We need open science. So the context has been very well defined with my dear friend, René von Schomper, that he was refining the context, the philosophical meta context of responsible research and innovation, which is a real context to make open science flourish. And openness is a transparency approach where the integral components of research and innovation has to be all together, including gender balance, education, open access and open science, ethics, and also citizen science and public engagement. In a renovated charter and code that I'm conscious that they are working on the new charter and code for research and innovation in Europe. And I think we do really need to have a renovated atmosphere on the way that we do science and the way that we need science, because it's not about, I have the right to do science because I'm a scientist, because I'm a faculty member. No, you guys, the citizens, you have the right of science. This is a fundamental right. And sometimes when we are looking at our careers, we think that we have the right to do research. It's the same thing when we are teaching. We think we have the right to teach. No, the students have the right to learn. We are just misunderstanding what is a question of rights. This is the normal approach of open science, where you all know that open science is an umbrella term, and citizen science is one of these components, but you all know that I have done my personal transformation with a biologically incorrect mushroom, because the mushrooms don't have roots. But the point, look at where I put the citizen science, because the citizen science is a transversal approach to open science. And another thing about these roots that I invented is that the reward system is one of the things that they have to make the foundation of open science to flourish. Of course, we need standards for research evaluation. We need standards for research infrastructures, and we need a standard for research integrity. If I was talking here to you about EOSC, the European Open Science Cloud, I would just be focusing on the standards to make European Open Science Cloud and FAIR Data happen. But I'm talking to you today about how to have standards in a new reward system, in a new environment when we all agree upon that, but we don't dare to change it, which is really deceptive. And if we have to talk about where we are, which is one of the first reflections of my speech, first, let me tell you where you are, where GRECO project is. GRECO project is at the end of the big journey and a very successful thing. And the point is that you are today putting open science into action and giving people clues to become an open scientist. when I was listening this morning to Ana Belén, that she said, no, you can't, with this enthusiasm that she always speaks, you can do something for open science. I was just hearing myself when I say, what are you going to do for open science? With your shoes, in your university, in your context, with your colleagues, you can do something, because we are thinking that the European Commission is going to make the open science happen. Now we want UNESCO to make open science happen. Or we want somebody to change the magic career assessment and open science would happen. No, it's a personal commitment. And you, that you are early career researchers, as Julia was telling to you, the Eurodoc is the context for you guys to push this open science practices. You, the early career researchers, you are the ones that you have to change the wheel. I feel like a hamster in a wheel in the COVID-19 situation. But I think all the researchers, we are a hamster in a wheel. Keep going, make paper. Just have another paper. And we miss the context, what is out there. So we need to think over what are we going to do. And we have to thank GRECO because they let us think about that we can do our own open science approach. This is one of my slides that I always, when I talk about the components or the elements of open science that we were working in the OSPP, that when Carlos introduced me, he said that I'm the chair of the Open Science Policy Platform. No, I'm the former chair of the Open Science Policy Platform because we finished our work last year in May. And I want to share with you our final results, our final report. But always when we talk about open science and the main pillars or the main components, we have to deal with the rewards and incentives because it's always the issue that we bump into and we realize that is the one that we cannot control. Science is not like in 19th century where the researchers were very rich and they do science because they like it. Now it's a career. Now it is an environment where you choose to do something on top that you have to the inspiration of science and research. It's something that is part of your life. I'm a faculty member, I'm a researcher. I live about this career. And also this is one of my favorite slides that you probably have seen it before. What are the motivators of will for academics? We have a motivator of will, which is finance, which is the projects and the money that we get for research. The second one is law, when you have something from coming from law, which is a requirement, a legal requirement, you do it. And also we have one other a motivator of will that we never think that we are interested in, but it happened to be that we all care about it, which is rankings. And the other motivator of will is seduction. And open science has to be very easy, has to be enough. We have to have enough help to make it happen because the researchers, we don't have time to deal with all this data management plan, all this perspective of publishing open access, publishing preprints, which is the difference of a preprint of a version of author or an author manuscript. This is crazy. We want to do research. So it has to be open science by seduction. And also in my previous talk to you guys in November last year, because last year for me was 2019, 2020 is in brackets still. So last year when I was talking about these topics in on GRECO conference in November in Politecnica of Madrid, I said that we want to change from the recommendation mode to the practical commitment for implementation mode, which is exactly what we were talking before when Anna was inspiring us this morning. What can you do in a practical level for your own career? It's something like you wake up in the morning and you say, today I will be an open scientist. And what I want to do is share my knowledge with somebody else, include citizens in my research. And also I will put in the repository the paper that I've submitted last week. This is what I can do on my own. So let's do it. Let's do what you can do it. And when we come up in the final report in the Open Science Policy Platform that we finished it up last year into 2020, and we come up with this main, I will say, some main recommendation or main areas where we really want to share with the community, taking into account that it's important to have these big challenges for making open knowledge the default situation in the new system. One of them is the academic career structure should foster outputs, practices, and behaviors to maximize contributions to a shared research knowledge system. The second one was that we need a research system that is reliable, transparent, and trustworthy. And this is something that COVID-19 has demonstrated, that we have to believe in science. And if science is not reliable, you cannot make, in the world of fake news, we cannot make science flourish. We have to demonstrate that science is the way to go. And also we need to have a research system that enables innovation. This is have something like the needed marriage between IP, the intellectual property, and the open science. We need to rebuild a new intellectual property system that comes to innovation and comes to a really competitive approach to science. And also we need to change a new research culture that facilitates diversity and equity of opportunity. This is something that the UNESCO recommendations, they really underline, and I'm very happy about it, because sometimes we forget, since we are in Europe, we forget that we have a big diversity of people with different conditions, with different money, with different culture, with different approaches to the problems that we have. And the COVID-19 has put all in the same page, but it's not the same the same thing having have COVID in Australia that have COVID in India. We have to realize that science is for everybody. And also we want to build up a research system, a knowledge system that is based on evidence-based practices. This is what I want to claim today. Guys, GRECO is a meta research project. Let's make meta science to make open science happen, because we need to research on the way we do research to really demonstrate that the way to go is evidence-based. Open science is good for the society and for the public good. And where we want to go from here, this is the final report of a period. The OSPP finished the work in 2020. And of course, we want to go global. And the way to go global is the UNESCO. I don't know if you have the opportunity to read the UNESCO recommendations that, as Julia was saying before, were adopted. The first draft was adopted last week. And we hope that 193 countries of UNESCO will approve in November, sort of the late fall, these recommendations to make open science global and happen. And of course, in terms of Horizon Europe, in Europe, the next step is Horizon Europe. And René was talking about this. And also in the new model grant agreement, you can see how important is the open science, etc. But it's what I said to you before. I don't want just to change the year. First, the year was 2020. Then we say, well, let's extend it to 2021. Then we say 2030. And the reality just overcome us. And the reality is that we want to open or crash the subscription model of publications and because of the COVID-19. The reality just make us a target, which is now, make open science now. I will not just stop very much on the evolution of the framework programs and what is going to be in the next Horizon Euro program, because René was talking about this. And also open science is a very important issue as an excellence. If you have seen the really new evaluation form for the Horizon Europe projects, one of the criteria in excellence is going to be the open science and citizen science. So this is a motivator of will again. And also we have infrastructures like European Open Research Europe, which is this platform that what it really pursue is giving back the science to the researchers. Because now it's something like the researchers, we have externalized our will to communicate to the publishers. And we need back the communication mechanism ourselves. It's giving back open science, it's giving back science to the researchers and science to the society. Also in the kingdom of the infrastructure, Julia was talking about also European Open Science Cloud. So I will not stop here because you know it. But the two key topics in the future is reproducibility, which is one of the main concerns for the European Commission and also for the researchers and psychology in medical science, but for the research as such. If science is not reproducible, it's not gonna be important for the future. So if science is not reproducible, you cannot demonstrate that you are right. And also I'm very concerned about what about null results? Because we only publish successful science. But what happened with the null and negative results? Those are very expensive. If we want the COVID vaccination, the COVID-19 vaccine, we need to know what is working. And also we need to know what it doesn't work, because we don't want to pay again to the same experiment if it doesn't work. So this is a clear approach to reproducibility and open the data, the good data that they are attached to a very successful publication, but the data that they demonstrate don't do this again, because it's very expensive to repeat experiments and it's our money as taxpayers. And the second topic about this in the future is the new research assessment. We need to address, the European Commission is now having consultations with the stakeholders. I will have a meeting in late June with the European Commission representing JERU, the Young European Research University Network, about how we can come up with an agreement, something like a memorandum of understanding with all the stakeholders, all the people involved in the research. We can define what is the bottom line that we want to go all together in the assessment. Not more impact factor, just try to evaluate researchers for the perspective, what they can do for the society. I know that this is time consuming, it's very lazy to just rely on impact factor, but the impact factor is not the way to evaluate the way we make science, because it's not gonna save us from this possible new pandemic or something that climatic change and these kind of things. So we have different approaches to evaluate, for example, the COCOM principles that they try to foster the research integrity. It's not to foster the research outcome, but the research process. We try to evaluate the research process and also the reuse of data by others. It will be something like a whole evaluation mechanism. We try to evaluate the stage of the research, not only the outcome of the research. We can evaluate research from the very beginning just for the idea. We evaluate projects, we give money, the commission, the national agencies, the funders give money based on ideas because they rely on ideas. Why we cannot evaluate the researchers relying on the study formulation or relying in the ideas on the micro ideas that they can just make the collaborative science happen. I have an idea. Who wants to join me? This is a wonderful way to do science. But let me finish up with these three really urgent changes that I think we need in the future. One is the way that we communicate science. Papers is not the way to communicate science. Is the standard thing that we externalize to somebody else, because in the 19th century, in the 18th century, researchers, they couldn't make their own communication system. But today with internet, we can make another more effective way to communicate science further than the papers. Second, we need to change the way we evaluate science. The journalistic factor evaluates the impact of the journal, not the impact of the publisher, the researcher, or the impact of the research as such. We are evaluating people for the car that they have. It's the same thing I will say, oh, Ana Belén is a very good person because she has a very expensive car. What is the relationship about she being a good person and having a very expensive car? No way. It's the same thing that happened with the journal impact factor. But you can say Eva is a very beautiful person. She's very pretty because she go to a 4-star hotel. It's not any relationship about my beauty and going to a 4-star hotel. So we are mixing up and we are relying on the evaluation in things that they don't matter. Okay. And also the third change that is urgent is the way that we give credit. We have to change the intellectual property context. We are trying to approach open science from a new ethical perspective, for a new code of conduct, for a new ethical approach. Why we cannot approach open science with new rules for intellectual property? We are applying copyright. We are applying the old law to the new behavior. And this is gonna be classic all the time. We need a new copyright, a new IP system, intellectual property rights that really promote innovation also, not only protection. And this is one of my last slides that I think open science in the future is the RR mode, RRI, RRS, and RRI. A, responsible research and innovation, which is the starting point. The right retention strategy, which is the new approach with the researchers, we are conscious about our moral rights of our creations and our discoveries. And also RRI of responsible research assessment, which is the way we expect to evaluate science in the future. This is the tweets that I was sharing with you in the first meeting that we have in Greco, that I would like to do these early career researchers or the researchers that you are attending this final conference to put a hashtag and say, I am an open scientist because just look for a reason to become an open scientist. Thank you so much, because in the last presentation I gave to you in November 2019, I told you that in the time of the Sustainable Development Goals, science is like a parachute. If it is not open, it's not going to help you. But I added this fantastic icon of the COVID-19 that demonstrated what I say in 2019. It was true. If science is not open, if we don't open patents, if we don't open knowledge, if we don't open preprints, if we don't communicate science in real time, we are all going to be in another pandemic, in another bad situation. Thank you very much. Congratulations, Greco. And next time we will go out together again. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Eva, so much for such a inspiring final talk, a perfect inspiring final talk for an inspiring webinar, I think. And thank you also, because I think we are on a schedule. I've been saying it and you've been realizing it all over the webinar, lots of discussions and things that we cannot go as deep as we would like, but I think we should tied to the schedule, because we all have very busy agendas, so the webinar must come to an end. The Greco project is also coming to an end. In fact, it will officially finish on Monday, so I think it is also for us a perfect finish activity that has been also very enriching our expertise and has help to put Greco in dialogue with other experiences and learning from them. Greco is finishing, but as I think it has been clear today, the need to work so that open science and responsible research and innovation becomes the way we make research, this continues. And we hope this webinar has given us inspiration to keep on and keep up. So thanks, really all of you. Thanks for the participants, for the speakers, the moderators. Thank you for making this webinar a reality. And yeah, we meet. I hope we can meet and keep in contact somehow, somewhere, around open science and responsible research and innovation.